inside Maxwell with OpenE.
I'm treating this buggy code to make it interrupt manager.
And I'm Charlie Fay, product manager for AIC.
What we have as a solution here with all our products is an active fiber channel iSCSI failover. And the solution involves the AIC system with Charlie. Would you mind talking a little bit about what we have there?
Sure, Todd, I'd love to. So the AIC server is a 4U in height with 24 hard drives up front, which is all shared storage to two controllers in the back. Active controllers that allow you to do high availability, continuous availability server storage. It's got dual node, both are hot swappable. It can be pulled out at any time for service or if there's any type of failure that occurs.
Charlie, now this has got a JBOT down here that's connected here, which is to your LSI, Avago LSI Synchro card. How many can I expand?
You can expand up to 11 JBODs that we've done testing on, but the true sweet spot is about 3 or 4.
Yeah. Okay, so you can expand more. What you want it with LSI, the Synchro card, would they want that or they want to add another Synchro card in there? Where does it max out at?
So we support 96 bytes per Synchro setup. So as long as you're able to fill the JBOD with 96 tries, it doesn't matter how many JBODs you play.
So really, if we're talking about a solution, we can have SSDs, we can have a hybrid solution, SSDs and SATs. And there's two servers in there. So with the solution we have, with the OpenE DSS V7 that manage all the components, at any time, logically or physically, we can fail one of those server blades and we continue the data write. Talk to me a little bit about the LSI Synchro card, the 92, which is the
9286 is our external controller, 9271 is our internal.
And we have both of them in here right now.
Yeah, correct.
So, at which point, this is great because we're able to see it and being able to manage it. Now, on the LSI Synchro card, are there any typical settings that most of you want to use? Or do they use the cache page?
Right. So we have a Synchro, Megarate is obviously the most widely deployed product. So Synchro is not a new product. It's based right on top of Megarate that you all So all the premium features that we have on Megarate or Synchro, so you can stick in an SSD card and then use the high bandwidth of the Synchro
Right.
And then make a cascade solution. So what it does is Megarate automatically detects the hot zones and caches the hot data in the SSDs. And then, that way you increase your performance at the IOPS.
So Charlie, right now you have fiber channel and we also are using the IE for the iSCSI portion. How many cards can we add more cards in there for you? 10 IE for the dual twin band. We have enough room there to handle many other products other than just one 5%
No, absolutely not. So each controller already has a 10 JP controller on it. And then each controller also has additional PCS plus options for 5 on one option and then 6 for the other. Actually, the best way to do it is to take a look at it inside. We can also show the
Let's take a look at that. Yeah.
So as you see from the back, you have two canisters or controllers that are 2U in height. Each of them are each individual nodes and are each individual servers.
Now these are these two right here, right?
Correct.
Okay. And so the LSI Synchro card is connected right down there to the JBOD in a crisscross fashion.
Yes, correct.
Okay.
And then so what I'm doing is going to attempt a exertion of one of the controllers, and we can take a look at the insides.
Okay, let's do that.
So what we do is,
and even if this is live with data, OpenE compensates. This is where the failover active solution with the Avago LSI Synchro card. So let's go ahead and do that.
Exactly. So it's a very simple exertion of the controller. You have two thumb screws up top, and you pull out, and then you just pull down the lever, and then the controller, actually, we should remove all the cables first.
Yeah, you get blocked in there. There you go.
Okay.
surviving node of Synchro must have detected that the other node has gone.
Yep, correct.
So now the failover aspect of it is happening.
Go ahead, Paul. You're right.
Drop the lever down, which also ejects the canister. And then we pull it out, clearing all these cables. While the system is running and still working.
And data is still flowing into...
That's correct.
Right. That's so beautiful.
So what we have is one of the nodes. As you can see, each of the nodes are a dual processor motherboard. Supports the latest Intel E5 2600 and also E5 2600 V2 series processors. It's got 16 DIMM slots to support as much memory as you can.
Now is the Avago LSI, where is it? That one?
Yeah.
Okay, now that's the 9271 for the internal.
Yeah, that's a 9271.
And then this one is, or which the external? Oh, this would be the external.
9286 AT.
Right. And then you got your dual BB battery backup units to accommodate to protect the cache.
That's correct.
That's on the Avago LSI Synchro cards.
Correct.
Great. Let's all put Charlie back on there and we can show on the DSS side.
Okay. So this is just simulating a service to the canister. We've done all the service and we're putting back the working controller back in. It's a very easy and simple installation. We pull the lever up.
Screw it back in.
Back in the thumb screw. We're ready to rock and roll again. And
let's plug them up. And it really doesn't matter if you mix those slots as long as it's on the opposite of the controller, the J-Bot. Yeah. So that makes it really easy and simple. So you really don't even need documentation. It's all automated.
Right.
So now he's plugging his fiber channel and his Ethernet. Let's power it back up, or does it automatically power up?
It should have automatically power up.
That's great. Let's take a look at the front end and look at how OpenEat DSS V7 manages. When Charlie dropped the server plate down, it went into this state here, an error occurred. So right now the system is preloading to go back up. Now the other DSS V7 is taking over control. So to show you that we still have the ISCUS and fiber channel volumes that we're running, we're going to go to this Windows 2012. We have multipath running. The multipath is what's creating the active-active solution. So here, we have the fiber channel and an ISCSI volume. What we're going to do is, while it's loading up, we're going to copy data. We're going to copy this file from the fiber channel volume over to the ISCSI into the DSS. So the system is booting up. Let's see if it's the DSS that Charlie pulled out on that server blade. And Charlie, that's installed on, the DSS is installed on a SATA down, but it can be also installed on an SSD drive. DSS V7, really, you can run it on any boot media. It's only about, it's under 500 megs. So our DSS, data storage software, is a Linux operating system with a GUI front end. So we're able to provide fiber channel iSCSI target and providing the failover solution with the Avago LSI Synchro using the ISC system. So obviously the other node, the other DSS node is still loading. So, and we're still transferring data. So what we're going to do is come back and wait till the DSS loads up, and then we can see. Also, what we're going to find out is we have both of the MegaRAID storage manager here. So here is where, when you set up the DSS, it's very simple to do. You only set up one side of the DSS server blade. Everything will then be replicated over automatically to the other DSS, including the Synchro, am I right?
Okay.
So here, we're transferring the data still over, and it continues to run. While this is booting up, we
and we'll wait for that. It should take about another few seconds. But let me talk about what the DopeNeat DSS V7 has. When I make, and I can make SCSI fiber channel volumes here, as many as I want, and as large as I want. Also, when you create an iSCSI volume or a fiber channel volume on one of the DSS synchros, it automatically gets copied over to the other DSS node. So the simplicity is really simple. Connecting the two DSS V7s is very simple in the configuration. We have a host binding. Once that host binding is connected, right now it says it's reachable because we boot up the other DSS. Once that comes up, it'll resync back up everything. But data can still continue to be written and read from as if nothing ever happened. So this is the beautiful part of the LSI and the AIC. So now the DSS is back online. We even do another copy to show you the robustness and the speed. So here you're seeing we're jumping immediately right back right onto that iSCSI line at about 500 megs. We go right back into the DSS that's now being rebooted. He placed the motherboard on or changed out module. We still log into the DSS. We get alerts that there was an issue. That can be emailed to you. Of course, we can go right back into the DSS and see that our volumes, fiber channel targets, iSCSI targets are still intact. What's really interesting is there's hardly any work to do. If I decide I want to create a volume group here, it will automatically create it for the other side of the DSS. And conversely, if I wanted to create, and we'll show this and then we'll wrap it up, y'all, is that here in the volume manager, when you create the iSCSI volumes and the fiber channel volumes, you can create as many as you want, and they will be replicated to the other DSS node. So here I have four. I'm going to create one right now. Let's just do something simple. We'll do 10.01 gig, so that way we identify it. Once you do it on one of the DSS nodes, it'll go over to the next one. So in a second, you're going to see it populate, and here it comes up. And while that's doing that, we're also going to have the other volume. So here you see the new logical volume that we just created. It's 1001 gigabyte right here. Now watch what happens. On the other DSS side, also the back to reachable automatically, it sees it, it resyncs it, we go into the volume groups. Here we see the new volume group that we created on the other DSS. It automatically sent that information. It's already created. And if we go where we created that iSCSI volume, we'll also replicate that information over to the other node of the DSS. So here, you can see the simplicity. What a great solution for a very inexpensive cost compared to the top tier vendors. What we provide with the Avago LSI Synchro solution, the AIC server robustness, and the DSS V7 by OpenE, creating the active-active failover solution, high availability for fiber channel and iSCSI volumes. Thank you.
Thank you.